Hi, everyone, and welcome to the Photoshop Show. This is going to be a good show. They all are, but this one especially, because tonight we are keeping somebody up all night who's going to regale us with his knowledge of Photoshop, and that is our special guest, the guy down there at the bottom wearing the headphones. That's Pierre-Étienne Couturier. Did I butcher it?
Yes. No. You did it. Say it.
And I also want to welcome our wonderful panelists, Mr. Dave Bell. You can wave to the folks.
Good evening, everyone.
And Ms. Karen Hutton. And my co-host, Ron Clifford.
Hello.
So as always, when we get started with the Photoshop Show, I'd like to give everyone a chance to say hi to you and tell you what they're doing these days, because each one of these people has an amazing life, both online and offline. So I want to know what they're doing. And we can start right there next to me with Mr. Dave Bell.
Well, good evening, everyone. It is always a pleasure to be here with you. I am actually a college professor teaching information systems courses, but I run around with my camera everywhere I can and just enjoy this community on Google Plus and have learned so much just interacting with the people here, and plan to spend as much time as I can here.
Great. And so are you at liberty to say where you teach, or is that?
Yes. I am in the north end of the Napa Valley, a little private college called Pacific Union College. Put in Newsweek in the fall as the most beautiful college in America.
Wow. So,
good place to be.
That's really cool. Well, Karen, you must know that area because you're also from California.
I do. I was long gone before Dave ever graced the area, but it is really beautiful, and he's right. What he said is absolutely correct.
So, Karen, what are you doing these days?
Well, I'm Karen Hutton, and my website is karenhuttonphotography.com. Let's see, what am I doing? I just had an ebook come out last month called We at flatbooks.com. It's a book of stories, little stories and photographs. And I'm getting ready to go to New Zealand. And I'm very, 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 very excited.
Well, that's really exciting. I think that got muted. Somebody was moving around. You're going to New Zealand, right?
I'm going to New Zealand, yes. I'm going to New Zealand to, hang out with Trey Ratcliffe and gang for his workshop. I'm there to assist or help or laugh at all the right places, whatever the case may be. And I leave in about a week and a half, and I'm really excited.
So is that workshop full, or can people still
join? It is full. People can find out more at, I actually have a link. I don't have the chat up, but you can find out more at Stuck in Customs New Zealand Photo Adventure is what he's calling it. And I have my little picture there and everything. It's going to be really, really fun. He's breaking new ground with these workshops, so it's exciting to, be a part of it.
Yes, it really is. It's a great thing. It's so cool. I'm very happy for you. I'm totally jealous. You have to tell him I'm coming next time no matter what.
I'll tell him.
All right, that'll be great. Yeah. And again, that's stuckincustoms.com, so you guys go over there and check it out. Okay, so next to Karen, we have our special guest, Pierre-Étienne. Can you please tell us something about you and where you live and what you've been up to all these years?
Okay, so I'm from Belgium, so the other side of the planet, almost. I'd really wish I could go. Do you need anyone to carry your luggage to New Zealand, Karen?
I kind of do. I'm actually taking way too many bags because I'm bringing extra things over, and I need a handmaiden, and you're more than welcome to audition.
Okay, so I'm a photographer, videographer for a big international organization. It's all over the place, all over the world. I'm also a Photoshop addict. I need to say it to all the entire world. I discovered Photoshop many years ago and was immediately hooked to it. I started to gather all the info I could back in the time when I had no internet connection, so it was mostly books, magazines, and so on. And I remember we were passing each other floppy disk with the KaiPor tips, for those that remember. It's a good thing to search, K-A-I Power Tips, the search it on Google, you will find a lot of cool, old school information on how to do stuff in Photoshop without layers. So that's how old it was. And then I finally had my own internet connection and then started to search for information. I joined several forums, started to ask questions, and then when I gained enough knowledge, I start to answer some questions when I could, and I became moderator on PhotoshopTechniques.com and some other places, Photoshop Gurus, I was moderator. Many places I like to moderate. Maybe Belgian are very moderate people. That's why we've got good beer and waffles and chocolate. Then I started also to go to the official Adobe forums, because that's where Jeff Shuey, back then the late Bruce Fraser was there. He was really a great, great guru. And they were all sharing all insider information, a lot of tips and so on. So I stuck up to it over there. And with the years passing by, I started to gather some information. So I helped Ian Lyons, who is a Photoshop and Lightroom guru, to build up the FAQs for Camera Raw, the frequently asked questions. And then with the time passing by, became moderator as well in the official Adobe forums, in the Adobe community help. I will talk about that later. So, and then finally was recently inducted in the Photoshop, Adobe Community Professionals, which is a big title, but in fact it gives us some background information about all the questions that the customer asked. And so we are asked to be active on Twitter, Google Plus, and so on to try to help as many people as we can. Hence me being here. Thank you, Ian and Ron, for the invitation.
That's really an amazing resume. I mean, I am floored by that. If for those of you who don't know out there, the people that he mentioned are the gods of Photoshop. You know, Jeff Shuey and Bruce Fraser, the late Bruce Fraser and Ian Lyons, and you. And really, it's an honor to have you here. And I'm really scared about doing a tutorial in front of you because you're the guy. Yeah, but that's really great. And you know, you were reminding me before the show that we met a long time ago when I used to run this thing called the unofficial Photoshop weblog. Remember that? And it was Jason Calacanis's first, what did he call it, like a web network, where he had a whole bunch of different websites, the unofficial Apple weblog, the Photoshop one, Engadget was one of them.
Yes.
And all, you know, some that really took off. And I'd forgotten that. The other place that Pierre and I ran into each other was on the very secretive, we do a little bit of testing for Adobe before the products come out to the world. And I've seen him posting there for a really long time, always right on posts, perfectly, you know, great. Always the stuff I'm interested in.
Thank you, but I can return you the compliment.
Thank you. Well, that's great. So pretty soon, Pierre is going to talk to us about what to do when Photoshop is acting naughty and it isn't doing what it's supposed to be doing, and how you can fix things in all those different cases. Right, Pierre?
Yes, hopefully.
And then finally, we have down there Ron Clifford, my wonderful co-host. And Ron works so hard on this show, on Google Plus in general, on the Photoshop and Lightroom community that we started on Google Plus, and as a photo mentor, all kinds of things. What are you doing this week, Ron?
Doing okay. I'm trying to stay warm. That's what I'm doing. Boy, it's cold up here. Man, is it that cold where you are, Jen?
Oh, my God. It's 65 degrees. It's going to be even more tomorrow. In the middle of winter in Colorado.
Well, I'll tell you what. It's about it's going down to about 28 below Celsius here. I'm not sure what that is, Fahrenheit.
What is that?
Cold.
It'll stick your nose together. It'll freeze your pipes.
Yikes. That's scary.
Yeah. It's really cold. Yeah. And we're actually a warmer part of the province. There, it's in Manitoba. It's 40 below. And up north from here, it's 40 below.
Whoa. So but aren't you going somewhere? I thought you were going to go to Haiti or something.
Yeah, I'm going to Haiti on February 18th. And so that's going to be a real shock for sure.
Yes, it will. And what are you doing there?
We're doing some humanitarian work at a place that's building children's homes in a small kind of compound village community. And so we're helping out an organization called Joy and Hope. And the long-term goal is to raise a lot of the orphan kids from the earthquake, because there's still a very serious problem there. And not just to raise them in a large institutional orphanage, but actually give them more of homes. And so there will be 8 or 9 kids per home. And, that's what we're going to do. We're going to help build the homes. We're actually, the crew we're going down with, I think we're doing some road construction. So it's going to be some hard work on hot days.
Wow. Oh, that's really admirable. That's great. I'm glad to hear you're doing that.
Yeah. And the other thing that I'm working on that we just got underway is we're in the second week of the advanced mentorship program for photographers. I'm running a special advanced mentorship program to carry on from the ones I had previously run. So there's a select group of people that were previously enrolled in my mentorship that we're going through a more advanced version of that. And we're just having a great time. And Google Communities is working amazingly in that regard, because we're able to have this small group of people in a private setting where we can have great sharing, different categories. The communities, that's one of the areas where they just really shine.
Yeah, I've been thinking that communities would really be good for classes. If you're teaching, for example, Dave Bell, maybe you can have a community for just a class you're teaching. And it's, you know how easy it is to have Hangouts and post things.
Yep, I plan on using it next quarter.
Yeah.
That's great. And it's also good for companies, like if you're having private meetings. I keep trying to do Skype with people, and then we give up and just turn on Google Plus and do a Hangout. Or you could have a little community of the people in your workplace. It's great.
Yeah, it really is.
It is. So, and you know, like a fool, the second day of communities, I hopped on there and made the Photoshop and Lightroom community. And we did it. I did it in a different way. I didn't make it real public. I made it public, but public in a way that's moderated. And that means that all the people who have been kind enough to join me in moderating that group, including Ron, have to spend lots of time looking through, you know, applicants who want to join the group. And it is a big undertaking, and I just wanted to thank you publicly, Ron, for doing that, and everybody else, David Marks, and
Ali
Al-Haj,
John
Lorenz,
David Marks.
David Marks is great. He's really helping out. So all those people, I love you.
Yeah.
Okay, so now let's get down to business. So I have to say in advance that this morning, because of the time difference between here and Belgium, we weren't sure if we were going to be able to get in contact with Pierre. And so Ron and I were making all kinds of little backup plans. And I put together a little tutorial this morning, and then I had to go off to work. The tutorial I put together, I did it so that it could, you know, take up a bunch of time if Pierre didn't show up. So here's what you have to do, Ron. You have to cut me off after 10 minutes, okay? No matter what I'm doing, because I could, you know, this could
go. Stopwatch is on. You've got 10 minutes.
All right, I got 10 minutes. So I'm going to share my screen, if I can find the thing. They keep moving it. Here's the screen share button. So you should now see Photoshop CS6 with a photo open. Do you see that?
Yeah, mm-hmm. We got it fine.
Terrific. So, this is Photoshop CS6, but I went into my preferences before the show under Photoshop Preferences Interface, and I changed the way that the interface looks, because by default now with Photoshop CS6, everything looks nice and dark, and that helps to focus on the photos. But I was finding that with this image, I couldn't see the dark frame around it against the dark document window. So I chose a different color theme here. And that's something that you can do, you know, come in here whenever you need to and change that out, in case you didn't know about that. So what I wanted to show you how to do is to build something like this, where you start with a photograph and you build it out into, in this case, a mat and a frame. And there's a special word for this kind of image that maybe you've been noticing online if you've been reading lately about design blogs. They're all talking about this, what are they called? Skeuomorphic. Skeuomorphic. Do you ever hear that word?
Mm-mm.
Well, I think what it means is a skeuomorphic item is something online that is designed to simulate something real. So in this case, it would be, you know, trying to make this look like a real frame and a real mat around this image. And other examples are for the Apple address book. If you look at your Apple address book, you'll find it has little staples in the middle, and it kind of is made to look like real pages. Those mm-hmm. are all other examples. And, you know, people are saying, oh, that's not cool anymore. That was good at the beginning of the internet when people needed to make, you know, metaphors to real life things in order to understand what was happening. Now it just gets in the way. However, I think it looks cool. So I want to show you how to do this. And I have an ulterior motive here, not so much, you know, that it's important to know how to design a mat and a frame, but there are lots of little shortcuts using the crop tool, using layer styles, and lots of other practical things that you can use as you do, as you build out photos into larger designs in Photoshop. So this is where we're going. Let's go and start with just this, a photo. This is a photo that I took, who knows where. Where do you think? Where do I take all my photos?
Museum.
In Paris. I took it in Paris.
Paris.
Just as I unclicked my mute button.
So this is some kind of puppet store, and I just thought it was so cute. So I took this little picture. Well, let's say that I want to add a big white mat around this to start the process of building out my mat and frame. First thing to do is to take a look at the layers panel. And this happens to be just a regular old layer. But this might be a background layer. You guys know how when you open a photo to start with, it often says background in the layers mm-hmm. panel? Mm-hmm. Let me show you that. I'm going to make this into a background layer so you know what I mean. So this is the way a lot of photos open. And if you have a background layer, you can't put layers beneath it in the layers panel. So one of the little tips that I show people all the time, some people are surprised, is that you can make this into a regular layer by just clicking on the lock on this layer and dragging it down to the trash icon at the bottom of the layers panel. And now it's a regular layer, and I can treat it like I would any content layer. I'm going to give this one a name. I'll call it photo. I'm a real stickler about naming my layers, too. Okay, next thing. I want to add this white mat around this image. Now, what would you do, Ron? Are you sleeping over there? I don't know if you're paying attention, but if you are, what would you do to add space around this image?
I can't say immediately because I was chatting and I missed what you were saying.
I knew you were.
Yeah, I was keeping engaged in the chat. Sorry.
Well, I think if I had asked most people, they would probably say they would go up to the image menu and go down to canvas size.
Yeah.
But the truth is, I don't like to do that because I can't do math in my head. And canvas size requires you to do math. We'll look at it in a moment. So I like to do everything as quickly and as visually as I can in Photoshop. So here's a trick you may not know for increasing canvas size, and that is to get the crop tool in the toolbar. And then with the crop tool, I'm going to move into the image, and in Photoshop CS6, you automatically get this bounding box around the image. I'm going to hold down two modifier keys, the Shift key to constrain proportions and the Option key so that I can make the canvas bigger from the center out. And then if I click on any of the corner anchor points and drag, you can see the crop bounding box getting bigger. And then I'll release my modifier keys. You got to do that first. Whoop, I lied. I will release my mouse, and then I'll release my modifier keys. Now, did you see that when I did it in the wrong order, it got messed up?
Yep.
So that's kind of an icky little thing. I call those gotchas. Were you going to say something, Karen?
No, I was just saying that's really cool. I didn't know this trick. It's I love it because I'm always doing the canvas size thing.
Yeah.
Well, I know you're really visual, so that would be good for you.
Yeah.
I know we all do things in ways, and we see someone else do it like, oh, what? Of course.
You know, yeah.
That's great. Love it. Thank you.
Well, then, like with every crop, I have to accept the crop by going up to the options bar for the crop tool, and there's a little check mark there, so I'll check that, and that gets rid of that overlay. So now take a look at the layers panel, and you'll see that we have our photo inside of a bunch of transparent pixels represented by the gray and white. What I'd like to do now is add a white layer beneath this one so it will show through where there are transparent pixels, and that'll simulate the mat in our mat and frame. Now, you may not know this either, but if you want to add a new layer beneath a layer, you'll hold down the Command key on the Mac, that's the Control key on the PC, and with the layer beneath which you want your new layer, you'll go down and click the Add New Layer button. But it's holding that Command key, the Control key on the PC, that puts the new layer beneath the selected one, as opposed to the normal behavior where the new layer comes in above whatever layer is selected. Make sense?
Yep.
All right, I'm going to call this my mat layer. And the mat layer currently has nothing on it. There it is. I'm going to fill that mat layer with white. Another little trick. If you look over on the left in my toolbar, you can see that I have red and blue as my background and foreground colors, respectively, in the bottom of the toolbar. But I'd rather have these be black and white for this exercise. And if you press the D key on your keyboard, D as in dog, or dummy, or Dave.
Dummy and Dave, okay.
Yeah, nice.
Our default.
There, Jan.
you get black as your foreground color and white as your background color. So that's
if I can chime in. I love mnemonics. D is for default. Those are the default colors.
Oh, I knew there was a reason. Thank you. That makes sense. Well, now I want to fill with white. And rather than go up to the fill dialog box and, you know, go through all that mess, I'd like to use shortcuts for filling. And to fill with whatever color is in the background color box, like in this case, white, I'm going to hold down the Command key and press the Delete key. On a PC, that's hold down the Control key and press the Backspace key. So Command Delete on a Mac fills that layer with white.
Who knew? That's genius.
Well, I wouldn't say that, but it's useful.
Is. Well, it is genius. I love it.
It is. Do you know who's a master of shortcuts?
Jason Joseph.
We had
Joseph.
Him on the last show. Jason Joseph.
He's Jason a master Joseph. Of
shortcuts. He's got a shortcut for everything.
He's the shortcut king. He's just the king, period.
Well, I have a real spiel about shortcuts, which is I'm usually, most of the people who take classes are not experts. They're more beginners or maybe early intermediate users. And the fact is they're having enough trouble without trying to remember every shortcut. So I tell people, look, I'm only going to tell you the really useful ones. I'm not just telling you shortcuts so I look cool. These are ones you might actually use, I would hope. So take it with that grain of salt.
And you still come out looking cool. It's just awesome the way that cool. works.
Oh, my God. All right. So anyway, I'm going to turn off the photo layer. There is the matte layer filled with white. Turn that back on. Okay. Now we're going to do something even cooler. I want to add a little black border around all of this that will become my black frame. If I were to use that crop trick I just showed you, that border would not be even on the top, bottom, right, and left. For example, if you look at this white mat, notice that it's thinner on the top than it is on the sides. Do you see that?
Mm-hmm.
So that just has to do with the proportions of the original image. So in this case, I want my frame to be exactly the same width all the way around. So that's when I need to go up to the image menu and go to canvas size. Now, Pierre, you may have something to say about that. I just made that up. I figured that out on my own. I may be wrong, but that's what seems right to me. What do you think?
No, it is totally right. I would do that, or I've got another idea for the same stuff. It's to use the FX button. You see the layer style? But yes. I think you will use layer styles anyways for the finishing part.
I am. But first I want to get it all set up, but you're exactly right. So now I'm going to go up to the image menu and I'm going to come down to canvas size. And here in the canvas size dialog box, big important thing is to check relative. And that means whatever numbers I add into the width and height fields are just going to be added to the current dimensions of the image. But if I didn't check relative, then whatever numbers I put here will be the total dimensions. Make sense? And we don't want that. I just want relative. And then I'm going to put in some number of pixels of width and height. And notice that I have this menu set to pixels. I think by default it's inches. So you want to be sure if it is in inches, put it at pixels. Now, how do you figure out how many pixels? Well, what I do is I look up here and I see the current size in pixels, 728 pixels wide, 562 tall. And then I can kind of say in my mind, well, that means I don't want 300 for the border, right? It's going to be too fat relative to the rest of this. I don't know, I'll pick enough. Maybe I'll try 40 pixels for my frame all the way around, 40 on each side. Now, let's say that might be too fat. Let's do 20 on each side. That's a nice, easy number. So in order to get 20 pixels frame on each side, I do have to do a little math. I have to type 40 pixels in the width field and 40 pixels in the height field. Do you know why?
Mm-mm.
All right, so this is easy math. And you know what? It's amazing how hard it is to do even easy math in your head. If you got a width of 40 pixels, there's two sides to this thing. So that's going to give you 20 on each side. And if you have a height of 40 pixels that you're adding, you know, 20 of them are going to go on the top and 20 on the bottom.
Of course.
Okay. So then we go and make sure the anchor point for all of this is set in the center, which is the default, and we click OK. And I think this dialog box is way more complicated than it should be for most people. You know, they look at this diagram, and if they go like this, they have no idea what's going to happen. Millions of arrows going off in every direction. So that's the kind of thing, reason I don't like to come in here. But I'm going to click OK. Now, we have more transparent pixels around the edge of the white frame, or the white mat, and they're all even. We got 20 on each of the four sides. So that's good. Well, now I'm going to make yet another new layer and I'm going to fill that new layer with black, and that will peek through in this transparent area. So again, I'll go over to the Layers panel. I'll do the same thing I did last time. Hold down the Command key, the Control key on the PC, and click the New Layer button. And I get a new layer at the bottom of the layer stack, which I'll call Frame. Now, another trick. I want to fill the frame with whatever color is here in the foreground color box. That's black this time. So it's a different shortcut than filling with the background color. To fill with the foreground color, which I actually do more often, it's Option-Delete on the Mac or Alt-Backspace on the PC. So Option-Delete fills with the foreground color. And, you know, turn these off and you can see the whole frame layer is black. All right, now comes the fun part that Pierre was talking about, which is, Pierre, what did you mention?
Adding layer styles.
And the reason I'm going to do that is to make this look more realistic, because right now it just looks flat. So if we want to go to that skeuomorphic style that, you know, is now considered not cool, this is what you would do. With the frame layer selected, I'm going to go down to the bottom of the Layers panel and click the FX icon. Pierre, what does FX stand for?
Special effects.
Like effects, but FX starts like with an E.
Like SFX, yes.
Yeah.
SFX,
if it were
like
special effects. It would be SFX. FX is like in movie and film and stuff.
That's right.
All the time, FX.
So the effect that I'm going to choose is the bevel and emboss effect, and that opens the great big layer style dialog box, which I have to move out of the way so you can see the image over here. Maybe I can. No, I can't. All right, so I then am just going to choose some different options for my bevel. There are many you could choose from, like you could get a hard style rather than a soft style, and that changed this edge over here. You could increase the depth to see it better. One thing I like to do is come down to an area of the layer styles that a lot of people don't go to, and that's the contours. If you click this arrow to the right of contours, you've got all this built-in stuff ready to go. So if I click on these different little dialogues or little thumbnails, look how the frame is changing. And I can just click through and, you know, somebody else has done all the work there for me. And that's just kind of combinations of different options for this layer style. So I'll go with that. I'll click OK. And now you can see my new layer style hanging off of the frame, of the frame layer. See it down there? That's very cool.
I just want to mention the past 10 minutes now, so.
Oh, no. All right, one more thing and then I'm going to stop. Let's say that I want to, two more things, and then I will. I want to have a little bit of more dimensionality inside of the frame. And to do that, I'm going to go to a different layer, and you might find this surprising, but I'm going to go to the matte layer, and I'm going to add a layer style on that one that's an inner shadow. And then we'll be able to see that inside of the frame. You wouldn't see an inner shadow if I added it to the frame, because the frame layer has no transparency. It's just all filled with black. Whereas the matte layer has that little bit of transparent pixels around it. So again, I'll go down to effects. This time I'm going to choose my inner shadow effect. You know, I can do things to it, like maybe increase the size or lower the opacity and say OK. And now you see how the frame appears to pop out a little bit?
Mm-hmm.
And if I want to have a similar dimensionality on the photo layer, then I'm going to click on that inner shadow that's hanging off the matte layer, hold the Option key, that's the important part, and it's the Alt key on the PC, and drag that inner shadow up to the photo layer to copy it. So that's a quick way to copy a layer style from one layer to another. And look at now how the photo itself seems to be pushed back inside of the mat.
That is really cool.
So here, if I turn that off, you can see the difference, on and off, and on and off with this one.
Oh,
and there's more, but that's all we're going to do.
Nice. Yay.
Love it.
Yay.
Thank you, Jane.
Crowd goes wild.
But it's really fun. You know, I know we always think of Photoshop as just a photo editing program, but it really is so much more. It's amazing what you can do with kind of graphic effects. So I urge you to explore those. And with that, I'm going to unshare my screen and turn the floor over to our special guest, Mr. Pierre-Étienne Courtois.
Quite a mouthful, huh?
It is. I can't figure out how to unshare my screen. Hang on, sorry. Give me a second with that. Here we go.
Just click the screen share. Click screen share once more.
I can't even find screen share.
Oh.
Probably on
I'm
another
back
window.
On the... Oh, dear.
Do you have a second window hanging out behind there?
No, maybe. Yes, I do. Thank you, Karen.
Mm-hmm.
So, Here we go.
We see your screen now, Pierre.
Okay, perfect. So I will start my little presentation of today by talking about troubleshooting Photoshop. We all know that Photoshop is a very stable application, but with the time, it has also supported graphic video card acceleration, and that is makes it detrimental to the quality of the drivers. We'll talk about that, the video card drivers. We'll talk about that later without going into the technical details, don't worry. But also sometimes we are testing stuff in Photoshop. That's the best way to learn. I do recommend to dive in Photoshop and learn, experiment stuff. What's this tool you don't know about? Click on the tool, look its name. When you click on the tool, it will should give you a tool tip. I don't know if you can see it here. It might be a little bit small. It's the brush tool that we all know it. But for instance, we've got here the background eraser tool. It's a very powerful tool. So if you don't know about a tool, just hover it, look its name, Google it. Yes, Google it. Search for tutorials about that tool. And I would recommend also to go to Photoshop Help. So you go to the Help menu and you type in that string of letters and you read, educate yourself. But while doing that, we might trigger some settings and make Photoshop misbehave. Ooh, what are we going to do? So I will start with giving you some common issues that I've seen during the years being moderator in many places or just being addicted to many online communities, including the Google Plus, Photoshop, and Lightroom community. And I will then show you the common errors, then show you how to fix those errors quickly. That's good because I could just show you what is the problem. Run away. But I will so then look into what, when you cannot see what is the issue, how to try to fix a tool. Then the dreaded reset the preferences. It's a look daunting. It looks really difficult, but it's way easier than resetting, than reinstalling Photoshop, and fixes way more problems than reinstalling Photoshop. Then I will let you give you some resources also to. Excuse me?
Nope.
No. Okay. Then I will give you some resources about where to find help in case you're stuck. Because, yes, sorry, Jan, there are other places than the Google community, but just ask there because there is really a huge amount of knowledgeable folks over there that can help you in a second. I've seen many thank yous being exchanged and many questions and thank you being exchanged over there. I'll talk after that about also how to keep Photoshop working for you to prevent problems. I'd say Photoshop hygiene. So I think that's quite a lot to cover, I hope, and that would be enough for today. So I will start then with the tools that misbehave. You might want to paint. This is waterfalls from Iceland, if I remember correctly. Yes. So you want to paint and add some of the blue color over there. And so what are you doing? You're getting the brush tool. And you know that you can use keyboard shortcuts to help you work faster in Photoshop. Jan said it clearly, keyboard shortcut as it can be really addictive. I will make a small aparté, as we say in French. Sorry, pardon my French, and that's why my accent is so strange. It's a mix of American accent and French accent, so it maybe looks like Canadian accent, I've been told. There are some little rules to remember with keyboard shortcuts. If you remember simple stuff, like when you are in the Explorer or in the Finder, to select one file, you click on it. To select several files, you shift click. So shift usually is add. Shift will add several elements when you select them. It will add several layers when you select them. Alt on the opposite, or option on a Mac, I think we all know that right now, is the opposite, is the alternate setting, is an option. So you're selecting another option. For instance, if you're using the Dodge tool, I cannot because I don't have any layer selected. So that's one thing you learn. You need to have a layer selected.
You know if what? You... I think that's the main thing that we all do. We forget to select the layer. All the experts, everybody.
So if you use the Dodge tool, if you use the Alt key, it switches to the, it should switch to the burn tool. It has the opposite setting. You see here, it darkens the image rather than lightening it. So I will change the setting. So this is lighting the image. I'm with the Dodge tool. If I hold on the Option key or the Alt key, I'm darkening. So Alt is the opposite. So that's a good tip to remember. It can help you in many cases. Making selection, Shift you add to a selection, Alt you remove from a selection. Also, one stuff that I want to say that can help you a lot is right-click does wonders. A right-click on a PC is usually called a contextual menu on a Mac. And contextual, it means that it gives you information related to the context you're doing, to what you're doing right now. So here I've got a selection. I can deselect. So that was the little aparte, the little off cursus I wanted to say about the shortcuts. So it's really good, and it empowers you, and you will work way faster in Photoshop if you know your shortcuts. So, but no, I am trying to paint, was I saying before I rudely interrupted myself. And I wanted to sample a color over there. So what I do instead of painting, that's why I came into that, if I want to paint, I lay down some colors. I undo. But if I want to sample a color, I use the Option key, and it turns you into the color sampler tool. And I can sample a color. And you can see here the new color ring that lets you see exactly the color that you are sampling, which is really useful if you're running CS6 on a machine that has a graphic card acceleration. But if you look closely at my toolbar, you can see that I sampled color with for the background well. And that's not what I wanted to do. I did not Alt-click with the color sampler tool. Where's the up over there? That's the sampler. But I did not want it to select the background. What happens? In fact, in Photoshop, you need to look at every palette all the time. In this case, that's a very common issue you see often on the forums. If you try to sample colors and you're sampling for the background well instead of the foreground color, look into your color palette. Color panel, no, they're called panels since a few versions, but for us diehard old school guys still call them palettes. And you can see that I've got the set background color box selected. So that's an easy fix. You just click on the foreground, and now whenever I will sample the color up, I'm sampling. Okay, of course, that's the live up, the. Yes, because I'm. When I Alt-click with the brush tool, that's what I think. I am sampling colors for the foreground. That's what I wanted to do. So it's quite easy to miss because it's very subtle here in the new interface. There is just a very thin highlight around the foreground well. But that's the first thing that often happens. But what I might have another issue I can hear all the time in the forums is where is my brush tool? I cannot see my brush
cursor.
Thank you. Sorry, 3 o'clock in the morning. It's kicking in. So what to do? It's easy. You've got your caps lock key hold press down, and now if I press my caps lock, that's the key on top of the left side shift key. You can see the radius of your cursor, and now if you use the square brackets, you can change the size dynamically. Yeah. So it's a quick error I see often. And something that you might do while trying to hit that caps lock key is hit the tab key. And what does it do? Where are my tools? What am I going to do? So the tab key is really useful because it lets you hide the tools. But when you don't know about it, it's quite troublesome. So if your tool disappears, just press the tab key. So those are really simple for us long-time users. But if you're a Photoshop beginner, that might help you. Now, a tool might not work how you wanted it to work. I'll try to find, I've got some image open here. Yes, voila. So this image was shown. No, it's not in Las Vegas. It's in Moscow. You might have a tool that does not behave the way you want because you changed the settings somewhere in the brush panel, for instance, and you change the shape dynamics, whatever you change, and it makes the tool paint in a way that doesn't, you don't want to, sorry, start again. So the tool does not behave the way it's supposed to. There is a very easy fix for that. You just go on top to your option bar. That's where you set the options of your tools. And you see here, that's the current tools that are selected. It gives you different presets. That's very useful because they also store the color you are using. So it stores all the settings of the brush panel for the brush tool, plus all the settings you've got here in your toolbar. And here, for instance, yes, I'm trying to paint. And if I wanted to paint, I noticed that, hey, it's doing something really funky. The fix is really simple. I am on luminosity blending mode. But it might be another setting that you're not seeing. In this case, just right-click over your current tool in the option bar, and you've got a reset tool. And this will bring the tool to its default settings. So that's the way it's supposed to work right out of the box. And this way, I've got here the cursor. I can see that I can change its size. And now when I paint with my, is it teal? I don't remember which the name of the color. That's not teal.
With my, you know what, Pierre? Excuse me for interrupting. I was going to say, I think that's really important. And every time I show people, they're surprised. They've never seen that.
Yes.
But I would say I do that almost every time I sit down to do a new photo, to work on another photo. I reset all my tools, not just a single tool.
Yes, that's the next step. Indeed, as I show you, there is also reset all tools. And it's usually useful in the classroom environment because you don't know what's been done in the previous class, so reset all tools. It will set everything back to the default. Well, the tools options back to the default.
I'm sure that's why it was invented, because somebody was teaching in a classroom and tried to use the computers after.
Probably.
Indeed. And then we've got the preferences. The preferences, it might be daunting as well because there is a lot of options. On a Macintosh, it's in the Photoshop menu, while on a PC, it will be at the bottom of the Edit menu. It's Control-K or Command-K. I don't know why, maybe because that letter was free. And in there, we can see, for instance, we can change the color of the interface. Let's do this for a moment. It's got plenty of settings. You can change the language if you install Photoshop with Creative Cloud and you install it in several languages. That's a big advantage of Creative Cloud. You can change the font size because there is a way to make it larger, but it needs a reboot in order to change. So that's a question I've seen, I think, on the Photoshop and Lightroom group over there. But sometimes the Photoshop preferences, they're supposed to be saved when you quit Photoshop. But Photoshop might crash. I hope that Chris Cox and the other Photoshop engineers are not listening to me. Photoshop, no, does not crash often. More often when it crashes is because of a plugin or third-party support that's crashing Photoshop. I've seen a graphic tablet drivers, usually non-Wacom ones, and I'm not paid by Wacom, but I use my Wacom tablet, never had any issue, and when I read online all the problems that users of all the brands of tablets have, it can be interesting. So what you need to to look first is when something started to misbehave. If it's when you added a new font, for instance. So that's a good hint that you should maybe look into your font menu and divide it by two, remove half of the fonts, and start troubleshooting that way. But we'll come to that later. But what might happen is Photoshop crashed at one moment, but it did not have the time to save properly its preferences. And the preferences can be all kind of settings, because it can be the size of the thumbnails in the layers menu. So there are countless of settings, so it's a fragile file, a file that's easily broken. So in case Photoshop really does not work, even when you reset your tool, you just quit Photoshop and restart it holding the Control, Alt, and Shift key on a PC, and Shift, Command, and Option key on a Mac. And you should receive a prompt asking you, do you really want to delete your Photoshop preferences? Often you will see online people will say, oh, I tried to reset, to reinstall Photoshop, and it still does not work. It's really simple, because when you uninstall or reinstall Photoshop, it does not touch the preference file. So that way, if in case your preferences are correct, and you change the settings the way you want, the color of the interface, the size of your thumbnails, etc., it will keep those settings intact. There is also a way to go hunt for that Photoshop preference file, and the easiest is just to search, for instance, in your in the search menu, and CS6, of course, it's the live show syndrome. I cannot remember the name right now, but you can just Google it online. You can search the location of the Photoshop preference settings, and usually it's in your user setting. So you've got users, I've got Peck, because that's my nickname, Pierre-Étienne Courtejoie, and on a Mac, because I'm more often troubleshooting on a PC. No, that's not preference applications, it's directly here. Sorry,
I'm lost. Let me ask you, as you're looking, are you trying to delete the preferences file? Is that what you're...
Yes. So because some users have a hard time, they might have an SSD that's making their machine really fast, and they don't have the time to hit quickly the Shift-Alt command keys, and it's not fast enough to delete those settings.
Right, I've seen that. I've seen that on the PC. What he's talking about, I think, is when you restart the program on the Mac, you could hold Command Option Shift as you restart, and on the PC, Control Alt Shift, and that's supposed to give you a little message that says, "Do you want to?" Something doesn't say throw away, but do you want to reset your preferences?
Reset your preferences. Yeah. Okay, no. I think I won't lose some time here searching for it. What I will do is just simply, once the show will be posted, I will post the path to those files into the Hangout and as a comment on YouTube. But simply, what you need to know, it's a file that you can craft yourself. You can create your preference and adjust Photoshop the way you want. You can change the interface as you want. So what you may want to do, once you've got everything set up, is go hunt for that file. So link later, it's a link bait. And you will be able to save that file. So that's why some users say replace your preference file, because you can keep a copy of that that preference file and just drag it to the folder, because it's a user folder, because you can have several users having each one their preferences, and replace that preference file easily. Now, also when I mentioned earlier that you need to look in Photoshop what you are doing. For instance, here, I'm trying to paint. I will switch the default color, D key, X to exchange the colors, and I want to paint on this layer, and nothing happens. So rather than go try to simply reset the tool all the time, it's best to educate yourself and try to find why it does not work. So a painting tool has different blending modes, but in this case it is normal. Prior I had it set to luminosity and it did not paint the way I was thinking it would paint. It can have also a different opacity, but your layer can also have a different blending mode. Maybe you created a layer for a certain purpose and you're trying now to paint in a layer that's set to darken mode. Unfortunately, the layers do not say their blending mode here right next to their name. It's me, I did it to as a mnemonic for me. What else can happen? You can want to paint and then, what am I doing? I'm painting and I'm seeing the background show through. I might have made a special setting, might have made a special change on the layer. And in older version, that was really a big puzzle. You really wonder what happened, what's going on. In fact, here it's just the blend if. It allows you to blend the image with the underlying layer. There are really cool tutorials about that. It's really a powerful tool because it lets you paint, it lets you merge different images in a gradual way. You can even split to make a gradual change. I don't know if you can see that. Because it can change the, you can see when, as I increase this, it can help you show an image through. But what I did, I had this set to a non-default settings. But you can look that now, thanks to Katrin Eisman, she's the one that's been lobbying for years. I've seen it on the feedback website. We've got now this strange icon over there that tells you, and if I hover it, indicates layer as advanced blending options. So if you see something funky happen on the layer, the blending mode is normal, the opacity is normal, the fill is normal, but you see this little icon, it brings you directly here to the layer style, to the blending options. So it's right next on top of the bevel emboss that Jan showed earlier. So you just click here on the blending options, and you can switch it back or bring it back to default if it's gray. It's also a shortcut to change the fill opacity. If I accept it, yes, it's there. So, but this little icon over there tells you everything. It's really useful.
You know, I have to tell you this, Pierre. Today when I was preparing that tutorial, that happened to me. I saw that icon. I knew I hadn't seen it before, but the truth is I didn't know what the heck it did. And I clicked on it, and then that box opened. I'm like, well, now what? So you have solved a mystery for me. You have answered a question I didn't even know I had. That's
yes,
great.
There is a lot of information in the layers panel. Whenever you click somewhere, it can do bring a different menu. You can show high layers over there. There is a lot to learn right in the layers panel, because here I just right-click one location. It's the blending options. I right-click here next to the name. It's I get another menu. I right-click on the image thumbnail, it's yet another option. And it's everywhere you click on the interface, you can have different settings. So I know Photoshop, during the years, has evolved a lot. So users have been asking for new features. Adobe has been putting the best feature, the one that they were deemed the best, or the one that they understood the user wants. Because, like for instance, in the past, people wanted to have different undo, because before there was just this one undo, control Z, that was it. And Jeff Shuey and others were asking for a way to have different undo steps, and instead the Photoshop architect of the time, Mark Hamburg, designed the history panel, which is really powerful because you can go back in time and do a lot of stuff. So that I'm diving way too much into other details. But so there are little stuff we've seen so far. So reset the tool with a right click on the tool icon on the option bar. Look at your Photoshop interface, because more often than not, the setting that changed something it's right in front of your eyes, but there is a lot of places where you need to look at. You've got the option bar. If you're using a brush tool, you might want to look into the brush settings. There is the layers panel. Now we've got also the very useful properties panel that will give you different options in CS6. And I hope that in the future they will invest a lot of attention into that panel. And one hint, one little trick I could say, since it pops up quite often, rearrange it and put it, for instance, here with the adjustments, so that it will not jump at you each time you click on a setting. So you can change.
Yeah, that's actually, I was thinking, I really don't like the properties panel because of the fact that it pops out and often covers up part of my photo.
Yeah, what I do recommend indeed is to move that properties, because it's really useful one. It will be used, I think, more and more with the time. Just move it as a panel, as a sticky panel, rather than a fly out one, and save it as a new workspace, so that way you can go back to that and it will never annoy you anymore.
Good suggestion. Well, you know, I have to tell you that it's we've been here for, what, we have about 10 minutes left, right,
yeah.
Ron?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we've been here for about an hour, but we started a few minutes late, so we're good for just a bit.
Okay, so quickly, I will go quickly go over some stuff. Also, now I'd like to see the part how to keep Photoshop working right for you. The first rule is update Photoshop. And I'm really sad because in preparation for this hangout here, I did not update Photoshop to the latest version. Now we should be running 13.0.4. And I'm still running 13.0.3. But usually, Adobe has made a really good updater. I saw it in Jan's presentation earlier. She has a lot of updates to push to her machine, but that's arrived quite often on a presentation machine, because it's our laptop that goes to the field, and we don't always have time to push the updates, or we re-image the machine and don't have time to push the updates. But usually you will see an Adobe logo icon over there in on the top part of the it's 4 o'clock in the morning now for me. I don't remember the name here. In the
bar at the top.
Yeah, the bar at the top on the Mac. Oh, sorry, it's appalling. So you will see an Adobe icon over there, and I think on the Windows it will be into the lower right corner, where all the information is stored at. And if you click in there, it will launch the Adobe Updater. And here you can go, if you don't see that, know that I told you there is a new update. You can go to Help, Update, and it will launch the Adobe Updater, the Adobe Application Manager, and it will let you know if there is an update available. So keep it up to date, because the Photoshop engineers are really busy fixing every other bug that are reported. They're trying to always improve the experience. Photoshop is huge. It's a huge application. It does 3D, it does video, it does everything for you but the coffee. But they change a lot of settings here. They change the whole interface here for CS6. So it's normal that there might be a bug or the other that slips through the cracks. And even sometimes they're fixing bugs in others' programs. If there might be a bug in Apple's handling of the cursor, and they will try to find a workaround and work really hard. So keep Photoshop up to date. So run the updates over there and make sure that you're running the latest version here, the 13.0.4. It fixes the issue where you see Photoshop is going into trial mode. I've seen plenty of users have that issue. Activation is, there is always a huge debate on the internet. Usually the people that did not pay for Photoshop are totally against it. But the issue is that sometimes you can run into problems when you're using it legally. So do update Photoshop. I talked earlier about the fact that Photoshop now can use your graphic card to do some magic. Here it's using my graphic card to rotate the screen. So that means that it needs to have the graphic card drivers up to date. On a Windows, you need to find what graphic card you are using. Usually it's either an ATI, I know it's been bought by AMD, or an NVIDIA. It might be an Intel if you're using an Intel motherboard. And go see their drivers section of their website to see if they don't have an updated version, because usually they also fix bugs here and there. And so running with the latest version, it's really good because it can fix or break your Photoshop if you're not. Also, Photoshop is a program that uses a lot of memory. Right now, memory is cheap. Even if you've got an Apple laptop, you can push put up to 8 or 16 gigs of RAM, besides if you do have the very brand new Retina ones. But even Apple gives a guide how to update your memory yourself. It's really simple. You just follow the steps on the Apple website. On a PC, if it's a laptop, you unscrew the parts and the in the back. You search for the kind of memory you've got, but stuff your computer to the max. Give it as much RAM as it can, and Photoshop will run really smoothly. On this machine, I did update change the hard drive for an SSD, so it's like a hard drive based on memory, and that makes really Photoshop fly. Because Photoshop uses a lot of the hard drive as a scratch file. It's the temporary file where it puts all the settings, while it keeps the memory as a cache. So it puts everything in the memory for faster action, but the real memory of Photoshop is a scratch file. What you want to do is make sure, in your preference, performance, that you allocate enough RAM for Photoshop. If Photoshop is starving on RAM, it will not work properly. But you need also to give some memory for the rest of Photoshop. If you're giving all the memory to Photoshop, like here I could give 7 gigs of RAM to Photoshop, but I want to process some images in Bridge. Bridge is very powerful. Learn Bridge. Bridge is good for you. Because you can process several photos, you can launch filters on several photos in Bridge. But if you allocate all the memory to Photoshop, Bridge will be starving on RAM. It will be run slow. And so try to find a correct balance between more memory and all the memory. A scratch disk as well. If you've got a tower or a desktop computer, try to find the fastest disk you've got, and select it as your active drive and drag it to the top, because it will use the drives in the order they're indicated over there. In here, if Photoshop misbehaves because of driver settings, there might be an issue in my graphic card that's not been set by Apple, because I forgot to mention, if you're running on a Mac, the graphic card updates are offered, quote-unquote, by the OS updates, by the updates of your machine, of your Mac. So each time you update Mac OS, it might get a new driver update, and that might fix an issue you're running. But sometimes, if you're running a new version of Photoshop, this is not true anymore now, but if it was Photoshop 13.00, sometimes some user had some graphic card issues, because Photoshop engineers cannot test every single graphic card out there. And the fix for that was to disable the graphic processor. So you were losing some of the graphic card acceleration, but at least Photoshop was working while they were working with NVIDIA and ATI or AMD to find a fix.
Can I ask you a question? Mm-hmm. Before you get out of this window, because mm-hmm. I think it has to do with some of these settings, I'm not sure.
Yes.
But Bridge mm-hmm. Tends to... And apparently it does for a lot of people, but I bet it's something simple. It tends to bog down and require you to purge your cache every time you open it.
Yes.
And do those kinds of things.
Yes, the Bridge cache has changed from version to version, so it's good when you install here the new CS6 version to start from scratch with the cache. I know it's not happy, it's not something that we want to hear, but really it's a new database. It's running a new database engine, even though we always say that Lightroom is the database-based program, Bridge also has a database because it needs to cache all the thumbnails. So it's a database for that.
So can you explain the tall and thin versus flat?
Yes, okay.
Maybe that's getting too detailed.
Yeah, we might run out of the... but basically, if you're designing, working on a panorama on a big photo, select big and flat. What it will do, it will have more cache levels. The cache levels are the numbers of zoom levels Photoshop keeps into memory. When you zoom in, it will go faster. That's really a simple way to explain it. While the tall and thin, I would recommend this one for web designers that will be working with hundreds of layers, usually maybe on 800 by 600 if they're designing for the a small phone or no, maybe the resolution are going higher and higher on the phones. The phone resolution is higher than the desktop resolution. But tall and thin, usually that will keep less cache levels. And does it change the cache tile size? No, it does not. But basically, it all depends on what kind of documents you work with. Photographers, I would recommend to work with big and flat. That way, it will speed up the zooming when you're going in and out your document, while the tall and thin is really optimized for the, as I call it, tall document. That is, it has a lot of layers, tall in the layers panel.
I have a question for you, and it just reminded me when you mentioned the phone. We heard that Photoshop has now been optimized for the Apple, what's it called, the high resolution, the
Retina.
The Retina display. Can you explain what the heck that does regarding file size?
Nothing.
Nothing. Because you know how I heard Retina display was something like two times the number of pixels packed into one?
What it will mean is that the graphic card will need to feed two times the number of pixels to the screen, because the screen has two times the size of pixels. And even sometimes it will scale them down afterwards, because if you're using one of the non-standard resolutions, it will launch way more pixels and then scale them down for a crisp appearance. And on the Retina Photoshop version, so that is the 13.0.2, I think, now the whole interface is way more crisper because they made all the change again, all the cursors for this new resolution. I'm not running a Retina here. But so it will not change your file size for your documents. That said, if you want to have a background image for your backdrop, for your desktop, you will need twice a large an image. And if you create websites, image for websites optimized for the Retina users, some recommend to feed a progressive JPEG, so that way it can feed the large resolution and lower resolution. But for that, I would recommend to look really online. There are some blogs dedicated to user interface. I think Django, B-J-A-N-G-O, is one of them. It's another Photoshop tester that's really, really into interface design, and he knows his stuff about Retina ins and outs.
Very helpful. But just to be clear, Pierre, if I have a regular, 300 by 400 pixel file and I want it to be half as big, I just do as I always did in the image size dialog box, correct? Nothing new.
Nothing new for what purpose exactly? To show it to somebody that has a Retina or...
Yes. Let's say that purpose.
Well, if he can show a larger image on screen than somebody else would. So if you were cropping your images you send by email to 1600 by 1200 or something like that, you might want to know send larger images so that they can see the image in their full glory, of course, after you added your copyright.
So that image will look smaller on a Retina display than it will look on a regular non-Retina display, is what you're saying.
Yes, or if they zoom in the image so that it fills the same amount of on screen, it might look blockier.
Ah, I see. Okay, got it. Thank you.
But it's the same image. They will see the same image and they just zoom in. If they zoom in so that they see 1200 pixels, they will see the same 1200 pixels you were seeing. It might be smaller on the screen, or they might be seeing more of the image on their screen.
And another question, you were starting to explain about purging the cache in Bridge.
Yes, okay, yes. Then, no, I'm switching to Bridge. Voila. In Bridge, you've got the tools, cache. You can purge cache for a given folder. So for instance, and do update Bridge. There is a Bridge update that's been pushed this week where there was an issue where Bridge was constantly refreshing its TIFF. It was constantly recreating the thumbnails for the TIFF files, and they finally found a fix. And so right this week, there, if you're running CS6, there is Bridge 5, because it's one version after, 0.0.2 that fixes that issue. So keep Photoshop, Bridge, Lightroom up to date. Look for that little Adobe icon that I hope that would pop up there so that I could show it to you, but keep it up to date. Also, a lot of people are complaining that Bridge is slow. You've got different settings you can change here. Here, but it's not self-explanatory. The icon is not self-explanatory. So right next to the star rating filter, you've got here browse quickly by preferring embedded images. That means it will use whatever thumbnail is inside the image. If you just shot your images on with RAW files, an F file or CR2 if you're running a Canon, it can use the embedded thumbnail. That's the JPEG that's inside the RAW file. It can use that to show your image quickly. So that way you can sort your image, and if something is fuzzy, you can already trash it. Well, if you select the thumbnail quality, it will use Camera RAW for the RAW files. And even it could also use Camera RAW for the JPEGs and Photoshop files if you select it into the preferences.
So which one makes it faster than you had yours always high quality checked, right?
I don't know. I don't know which one I had. It all depends what I'm doing in Bridge. Because if I'm importing a lot of images and I'm in a hurry before a Google Plus Hangout and I haven't selected my images, and those are RAW files, I would switch to the browse quickly. But the high quality, that's what you want. Ultimately, what you want to do once you deleted the ones where somebody is clearly in the frame, it's not something that the magical Photoshop tools can fix. Switch to the high quality and generate 100% previews, because then when you'll be looking at the previews of the images in Bridge, the zoom will load almost instantly. So a good thing, review your images with the embedded images and then switch to quality. If you've got a lot of images, you can let it crank overnight. Point to the back of the root of your images and build an export cache and all folders, so you can go to the root and let it work overnight. That's a good settings that will let Bridge recreate all the thumbnails for you.
And what if you purge the cache? Do you lose your keywords or other metadata that you've added?
No, normally the cache is only the thumbnails. The metadata is supposed to stick. Normally, they are inside the files in case of JPEGs. The metadata would be outside of the file in case of RAW files that are NEF files. The DNG files, which are the holy grail of RAW files. It's a RAW file that's been created by Thomas Knoll, so which is the original creator of Photoshop, the guy that's also behind Lightroom, behind Camera Raw, behind everything that's cool inside Photoshop. He had created a RAW file format that lets you put all the data inside a single file, including the metadata. It has pros and cons. But its real goal is not normally to convert all your files you raw files into that. You can do that, but its real goal would be for a camera manufacturer to adopt it. What does it mean if they adopt the DNG file format? Is that the day you purchase a new camera, it will be supported in Camera Raw. Usually when there is a new brand new camera out and you see people start complaining on the forums, oh, I cannot open it. First, they need to check if Photoshop is up to date and Camera Raw is up to date. That way, because when updating to Camera Raw, you can update your camera to a new Camera Raw to new profiles for the new images, the new camera. And also, if you're running an older version of Photoshop, which would be very sad, you can use the DNG converter in that case to convert the images to DNG, and the DNG being an international format, transmission format, it can be open a version up to for Camera Raw 2.4, which means Photoshop CS1. So I see often people say, be upset that they cannot update, open the files from the new camera in their old version of Photoshop. No, they can. Photoshop created is the only manufacturer that created a piece of software. It's the DNG converter that lets you convert your proprietary RAW files. Proprietary doesn't mean it has secret sauce in there. The manufacturer don't want to tell what they've got in there, even though their files are really close to a DNG file. You can convert them into a format that will that can be open even in other software. If you're running Aperture because you might not like Lightroom, I don't know how that could happen. No, but that happens because you might be editing your photo in iPhoto and you've got a huge library of photo already edited and you want to continue with that with Aperture. It's your choice. But you can even use DNG files in there and even unsupported files. If Apple supports the totality of the DNG specification, what does it mean? They've got different versions of DNG. If they support the latest one, they can import a photo that's not known, a format that's not known in a program, and it should be open in that program.
You know, I agree with you. It's very important to update your Camera Raw. Another reason that people don't always know is if you're going to use Lightroom and Photoshop together on RAW files, you want to have the very latest or matching versions mm-hmm. of Camera Raw and Lightroom, and they are matching. So if you have, Lightroom 4.3 matching Camera Raw 7.3, for example, would be that. And I want to go back and ask you this because I really need to understand this. What is the difference in bridge between build and export cache and purge cache for folder or whatever?
Okay. Looks like an exam here.
Yeah. No, I just want to know.
Now, build and export cache, what it will do, it will create the cache and save a cache normally inside the folders. If this is set here, you can have a cache file, I don't remember its file extension, directly in the folder. That means if you burn a whole folder with the cache, it should be faster to be open in another computer. And here you can also select to build 100% previews. That means that's the one you use in the preview panel. Purge cache, just purge the cache. If you just purge the cache for this folder, it will just purge the cache for this very folder, while build and export cache is used, as I said, in the root, in the main folder that contains all your images. You click build and export cache overnight, while on the 4 o'clock in the morning, for instance, and then you can let it go, and it will create the cache for all the subfolders. So that's really maybe the first step you should do. While running Bridge for the first time, it's let it know about your images so that it will be faster and opening them. It will know also all information about the images. It will know all its metadata. It will have read everything needed. I don't know if I still have 1 minute or two.
We've gone pretty far over.
Okay. Yeah. So, but then I will put all the links because those were the links of the page I would recommend to use if you're still stuck in Photoshop. So first look in the help files there is the feedback.community.photoshop.com. That's a place where you can ask a question where really you stuck in Photoshop. I do not recommend that or how to make a frame. I would go to Google Plus, to the Google Plus community, ask over there, and maybe Jan or somebody will point to this very recording here. This is more for, I would recommend to use this for more technical questions. Then we've got the Adobe forums. I will put the link later. And that's where a lot of Adobe engineers hang out as well. As many user, oh, a face I know. That's myself.
There you are.
So that's a place I would recommend to hang out there, and then also the Google Plus community.
So what we'll do with those links, if you have them, we can put them on the actual event page, and then when I have the YouTube video ready in its final version, I'll add that right into the comment section.
Yes, exactly. I will email you those links maybe tomorrow morning for me. It will be might be during the night. I don't know if you want everything. I don't know when you're publishing the Hangout. Already after the show? Immediately after the show?
Sorry, what was that?
Will you publish it immediately after the show?
It'll be viewable right after the show, but I edit it a little bit, and then I put it up tomorrow at the finished version.
Okay, so then I will email you all the links I recommend to educate yourself and also to ask questions. So if you're stuck after resetting the preference, reinstalling Photoshop, whatever, go there to ask for help.
And, you know, you have been so helpful. I can't thank you enough. I want to recommend, you know, to our panelists and anybody out there listening that you go to YouTube and you find where this particular show is and share it with your friends, because this is something that you can't find out anywhere else. I really can attest to that. I've been doing this for years, and I know all the little secret places. And Pierre has told me things that I don't know and that I don't know where to go look for.
Oh, so I'm really already cool. Ready to watch this again a couple of times.
Me too. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. Yes. Yeah. But I was thinking what would be nice to do, and I was thinking that, yes, there's never been a show about how to fix Photoshop or how to fix your usage of Photoshop so that you know how to work better and faster.
You could probably like pull a big audience doing this every week.
Yeah,
just on that, I think.
Yeah, but I'd select another schedule maybe so that I would be more eloquent.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't stumble on every word and be more prepared than here in the middle of the night.
Well, maybe we'll do it sometime in the morning, and then it'll still be on YouTube. That's the great thing about Hangouts.
Exactly, yes. And anyways, there are...
Yeah.
Excuse me?
I say we can alter our schedules to do a recorded version, no trouble.
Yeah, no problem. But anyways, there is always somebody that's on the other side of the world. I sometimes, when I see some Adobe presentations, I sometimes see some Kiwis over there, some people from New Zealand, and it's affectionate, you know. It's not.
Yeah, we've got someone from Australia in the chat tonight. We've got someone from China in the chat tonight.
Howdy, hello.
International Day.
Yes. Okay, so I hope I was not too technical and not too fuzzy in my flow of thoughts. And if you've got any questions, so I am hanging out anyways in the Google Plus community. I'm moderator on the Adobe forums. I'm at Spectra on Twitter. It's like the evil guys in...
Bond.
James Bond, yes, voilà. But it's just because it has my initials, and it's Spectre is also the spectrum, like the color spectrum. Yeah. I found it fitting.
And is there still a PhotoshopTechniques.com, or is that over?
Yes and no. The website is still there, but she suffered a lot during merging with another forum because she's been purchased by Mogo Media. It's another great place to learn about Photoshop. I know that Jan is making presentation for Lynda.com. I do for Video to Brain, and there is Mogo Media. They do some shows, in fact, in some places. There is a lot of places to learn. I think we all benefit from learning, and remember that all those commercial sites often have also free extracts, so it's useful to look for. And also I would recommend, I know I'm talky, to go to tv.adobe.com, and that's a huge a place where you see a lot of tutorials as well to learn the programs.
Yes, that is a great one. Well, it's been so wonderful to have you here. I want to talk to you some more. So sometime when it's during the day, let's talk, because I'm interested in knowing more about the Photoshop and Lightroom communities in Europe, which is something we don't know very much about here in America. And I have a feeling they're huge, and that you have resources there and things that you could tell us. You know, we should talk about that. Be interested.
Yeah, indeed. That's what is cool about the internet. That's what I loved about the internet, being myself an infoholic. I'm crazy about information. I'm trying always to learn and scavenge and look for information. But yes, there is so much knowledge out there, all over the place, and I wish I could talk many languages to learn some tips in the Chinese forums or whatever place there is. So it's always good to be able to hang out with people all over the place, all over the world.
So can I ask you a favor? Can you unshare your screen now so that we
yes.
can...
You know, see my ugly face. My face.
Beautiful face.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
I see Karen.
Click the screen share button once more.
Yep.
There you are.
Okay. Oh, yes, I should have put a parental warning advisory needed. Yes, okay. So sorry, but it's too early for me.
It's soon early for you asleep. And it's late for me.
Soon you'll be asleep and it'll all be a memory.
Yes. Yes, I'll be sleeping over this.
Well, you go and get a nap, and the rest of us will go and relax after our long days. Yeah. Thank you, everyone, for coming. Thank you, all you listeners out there, and we will see you in 2 weeks from now with another wonderful, amazing guest. And goodbye.
Goodbye.
Have a good night.
Au revoir.
Au revoir.